From Pacifica, this is Democracy Now.
Les informo que hoy he disuelto el Parlamento de Cataluña.
Today, I have dissolved the Parliament of Catalonia.
Spain's government seizes control of Catalonia just after Catalonia's regional parliament votes for independence. We'll speak with journalist John Carlin, who reported for the Spanish newspaper El País for nearly two decades before he was fired 2 weeks ago, writing an article headlined Catalan Independence, Arrogance of Madrid Explains This Chaos. Then to Puerto Rico, where the governor says he's canceling the controversial $300 million contract with Whitefish Energy, which was based in the tiny hometown of Interior Secretary Ryan Zinke. Democracy Now! Is just back from Puerto Rico and got reaction from the head of the Puerto Rico Electrical Workers Union, Ángel Figueroa Jaramillo.
A much deeper investigation needs to be carried out. Money is stolen and then nothing happens. I believe that this is the time to make sure that these contracts don't happen again, to take this to the ultimate consequences, and if people need to be put in prison, the local and federal officials who may have been involved in this whitefish process need to be put in prison as well.
Then tensions continue to mount between the United States and North Korea.
No mistake, any attack on the United States or our allies will be defeated. Any use of nuclear weapons by the North will be met with a massive military response, effective and overwhelming.
All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. President Trump's former campaign chair, Paul Manafort, and his former business associate, Rick Gates, were told to surrender to authorities Monday after a federal grand jury in Washington, D.C., handed down the first indictments in special counsel Robert Mueller's investigation into Russia's alleged interference in the 2016 presidential election. It's not yet clear what charges the pair face, but Manafort is under investigation over his foreign lobbying efforts. Mueller is also investigating whether Trump associates engaged in money laundering or tax evasion, and whether Trump's firing of FBI Director James Comey last May constituted obstruction of justice. After news of the indictments broke, President Trump lashed out against Hillary Clinton and the Democratic Party, tweeting, quote, "All of this Russia talk right when the Republicans are making their big push for historic tax cuts and reform. Is this coincidental? Not," the president tweeted. Meanwhile, the New York Times reports Russia's government provided a memo to a Russian lawyer ahead of her June 2016 meeting in Trump Tower with Trump campaign officials. The meeting, which was attended by Donald Trump Jr., Jared Kushner, Trump's son-in-law, Paul Manafort and others, came after the lawyer, Natalia Veselnitskaya, promised damaging information on Hillary Clinton in an attempt to help Trump win the presidency. Veselnitskaya previously said she attended as a private lawyer and was not acting on behalf of the Kremlin. But the Times reports she met with Russia's prosecutor general ahead of the meeting and that she carried a memo with whole paragraphs written verbatim by the Russian official's office. Defense Secretary James Mattis said Saturday the threat of a nuclear attack by North Korea is accelerating, warning the Trump administration is prepared to launch an all-out assault on the nation of 25 million people. Mattis was speaking alongside his South Korean counterpart during a visit to Seoul.
Make no mistake, any attack on the United States or our allies will be defeated. Any use of nuclear weapons by the North will be met with a massive military response, effective and overwhelming.
Mattis's threat came as Vice President Mike Pence toured an intercontinental ballistic missile launch site at an Air Force base in Minot, North Dakota, telling airmen the Trump administration is prepared to launch an attack on North Korea.
The threats we face today mean that, once again, America's security and our very future depend on the airmen of Minot being ready and being prepared. History attests the surest path to peace is through American strength. There's no greater element of American strength. There's no greater force for peace in the world than the United States nuclear arsenal.
Pence's visit came as the Trump administration seeks to expand the U.S. nuclear arsenal. A draft of the Nuclear Posture Review, reviewed by top administration officials last month, calls for new low-yield nuclear warheads, sea-launched nuclear-armed cruise missiles, preparations for possible nuclear weapons tests, and an easing of conditions under which the U.S. might launch a nuclear attack. In Somalia, al-Shabaab fighters stormed a hotel in the capital, Mogadishu, Saturday, killing at least 29 people, wounding more than 30 others. The attack began as militants set off a truck bomb to blast their way through the fortified entrance to the hotel. Minutes later, the fighters went room to room, shooting guests. Witnesses say the men used identity cards from the country's intelligence service and were dressed in the agency's uniform. The assault came ahead of a planned meeting at a hotel between Somalia's president and other top officials. The latest attack came 2 weeks after a massive bombing in Mogadishu killed at least 358 people and wounded 400 others. Spain's government has taken control of Catalonia, stripping the northeastern region of its autonomy in efforts to crush Catalonia's independence movement. On Friday evening, Spanish Prime Minister Mariano Rajoy announced his cabinet had fired Catalan leader Carles Puigdemont and dissolved Catalonia's parliament under Article 155 of the Constitution, which has never been used in Spain's modern democratic history. Rajoy ordered regional elections to be held in December. The announcement came just after Catalonia's regional parliament voted for independence by a margin of 70 to 10. In Barcelona, Carles Puigdemont denounced Rajoy's actions, saying the Spanish leader was removing a democratically elected administration. He called for continued peaceful defiance.
The best way to defend the achievements reached to date is the democratic opposition to the application of Article 155. We must do so by preserving ourselves from repression and threats, by doing so without ever abandoning, never at any time, civic and peaceful conduct.
Sunday, hundreds of thousands of pro-unity demonstrators waved Spanish, Catalan and European Union flags on the streets of Barcelona. We'll have more on the crisis in Catalonia after headlines. In Puerto Rico, Governor Ricardo Rosselló said Sunday he's ordering Puerto Rico's Electrical Power Authority to cancel its controversial $300 million contract with the tiny Montana-based company Whitefish Energy. The governor's move came after enormous pressure and scrutiny over the contract to reconstruct Puerto Rico's electrical power grid devastated by Hurricane Maria. The company Whitefish is based in the tiny hometown of Interior Secretary Ryan Zinke, and the head of the private equity company that backs Whitefish was a Trump campaign donor. Late last week, a leaked copy of the contract sparked even further outrage after it surfaced that the terms barred penalties for work delays and prohibited the project from being audited. This is Ángel Figueroa Jaramillo, president of Puerto Rico's Public Utility Union, speaking on Democracy Now!
We understand that this decision by the governor is in the face of the major questions that have been raised and the doubts that are circulating as to whether FEMA is going to be able to reimburse the money. And given the possibility that FEMA has distanced itself from reimbursing the money and given the invoicing of $11 million, the governor is calling for the contract to be canceled. Nonetheless, in this process, he has not called for the resignation of engineer Ricardo Ramos, which is fundamental. He is the one who has defended this contract. He does not talk about continuing to investigate this whole process, and above all else, does not talk about cooperating in any federal investigation that might be undertaken into the Whitefish contract.
We conducted that interview on Sunday, after spending the weekend in Puerto Rico, and we'll have an exclusive report later in the broadcast with an extended interview with the head of the Electrical Power Union. Two more women have stepped forward with allegations against disgraced movie mogul Harvey Weinstein, bringing the total number of women charging sexual harassment and assault to at least 60. Actor Annabella Sciorra told The New Yorker Weinstein forced his way into her apartment in 1992 and raped her. And actor Daryl Hannah says Weinstein repeatedly tried to force his way into her apartment, leading her on one occasion to barricade herself in her room using furniture. The latest revelations came as Rose McGowan told The New York Times she was offered a $1 million hush money payment if she signed a non-disclosure agreement not to come forward with her charges that Weinstein raped her at the Sundance Film Festival in 1997. McGowan spoke Friday at a women's conference in Detroit.
I have been silenced for 20 years. I have been slut-shamed. I have been harassed. I've been maligned. And you know what? I'm just like you. Because what happened to me behind the scenes happens to all of us in this society, and that cannot stand, and it will not stand.
More women have come forward to accuse George H.W. Bush of sexual assault, bringing the number of his accusers to five. Among them is former Maine Senate candidate Amanda Staples, who said on Instagram Bush groped her in 2005 as she posed for a photo with the former president. Meanwhile, the White House confirmed Friday that its official position is that all 16 women who've accused President Trump of sexual misconduct are lying. This is White House Press Secretary Sarah Huckabee Sanders being questioned by CBS's Jacqueline Alemani.
At least 16 women accused the president of sexually harassing them throughout the course of the campaign. Last week, during a press conference in the Rose Garden, the president called these accusations fake news. Is the official White House position that that all of these women are lying?
Yeah, we've been clear on that from the beginning, and the president on it.
A newly declassified document shows the CIA considered a plan in the early 1960s to plant bombs in Miami, slaughter Cuban refugees, and assassinate Cuban exiles, all in a bid to turn world opinion against Cuban leader Fidel Castro. The document was one of nearly 3,000 files related to the assassination of President John F. Kennedy made public last week. A memo to top military General Maxwell Taylor in April of 1962 describes planning for Operation Mongoose, a covert program aimed at subverting and overthrowing the Cuban Revolution. One part of the document reads, quote, "The terror campaign could be pointed at Cuban refugees seeking haven in the United States. We could sink a boatload of Cubans en route to Florida, real or simulated. We could foster attempts on lives of Cuban refugees in the United States, exploding a few plastic bombs in carefully chosen spots." Another portion of the memo describes plans to unleash biological and chemical agents on Cuban farms in a bid to cause crop failures. In New York City, thousands of people marched over the Brooklyn Bridge on Saturday, marking the five-year anniversary of Superstorm Sandy and calling for urgent action on climate change. On October 29, 2012, the hurricane blasted New York, New Jersey and parts of New England with a record storm surge as high as 13 feet, ultimately killing 159 people along the East Coast and damaging more than 650,000 homes. The storm caused $70 billion in damage across eight states. Saturday's marchers called on state and city officials to invest in clean energy while divesting from fossil fuel companies and the banks that finance them. In sports news, dozens of members of the Houston Texans NFL team took a knee on sat during the playing of the national anthem ahead of a game against the Seattle Seahawks Sunday, following disparaging remarks by billionaire team owner Bob McNair. The demonstration came after ESPN reported McNair complained to other team owners about player protests against racial injustice and police brutality during a meeting last week, saying, quote, "We can't have the inmates running the prison," unquote. McNair later apologized for the comment. Bob McNair is a major supporter of Donald Trump, who helped fund his campaign and gave $1 million to Trump's inaugural committee. And Dennis Banks, the legendary Anishinaabe leader and Native American activist, has died at the age of 80. In 1968, Banks co-founded the American Indian Movement. A year later, he took part in the occupation of Alcatraz Island in California. In 1972, he assisted in Ames Trail of Broken Treaties, a caravan of numerous activist groups across the United States to Washington, D.C., to call attention to the plight of Native Americans. That same year, AIM took over the Bureau of Indian Affairs building in Washington, D.C. In early 1973, AIM members took over an occupied Wounded Knee on the Pine Ridge Indian Reservation for 71 days, which some have come to call Wounded Knee 2. Speaking with Democracy Now! In 2012, Dennis Banks recounted how he was taken from his family in the 1940s and forced into a boarding school along with thousands of other Native American children.
I was taken to boarding school when I was 4 years old, taken away from my mother and my father, my grandparents, who I stayed with most of the time, and just abruptly taken away and then put into the boarding school 300 miles away from our home. And, you know, the beatings began immediately. Almost the de-Indianizing program. It was a terrible experience that the American government was experimenting with, and that was trying to destroy the culture in the person, destroy the Indianness, and then save the human being, save them, kill an Indian, save the man.
Dennis Banks remained politically active throughout his life. Last winter, he joined protests against the construction of the Dakota Access Pipeline at Standing Rock Reservation in North Dakota. Dennis Banks died Sunday night due to complications from heart surgery. He'll be laid to rest in his home community of Leech Lake, Minnesota. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman.
And I'm Nermeen Sheikh. Welcome to our listeners and viewers around the country and around the world. We begin today's show with the political crisis in Spain. The Spanish government has taken control of Catalonia, stripping the northeastern region of its autonomy in efforts to crush Catalonia's independence movement. On Friday evening, Spanish Prime Minister Mariano Rajoy announced his cabinet had fired Catalan President Carles Puigdemont and dissolved Catalonia's parliament.
Que hoy he disuelto el Parlamento de Cataluña.
Today, I have dissolved the Parliament of Catalonia and have called for elections next December 21st in that region. Yesterday, the Generalitat president had a chance to return to legality and call elections. That is what the great majority of the people in Catalonia were asking for. He did not want to do this. So the government of Spain will take the measures to recover legality.
Prime Minister Rajoy's announcement came just after Catalonia's regional parliament voted for independence by a margin of 70 votes to 10. The Spanish Senate in Madrid swiftly responded by granting Rajoy unprecedented powers to impose direct rule on Catalonia under Article 155 of the Constitution, which has never before been invoked. Article 155 enabled Rajoy to fire Puigdemont and take control of Catalonia's civil service, finances, police and media. Puigdemont denounced Rajoy's actions, saying the Spanish leader was removing a democratically elected administration. He called for continued peaceful defiance.
The best way to defend the achievements reached to date is the democratic opposition to the application of Article 155. We must do so by preserving ourselves from repression and threats, by doing so without ever abandoning, never at any time, civic and peaceful conduct.
Meanwhile, on Sunday, tens of thousands of pro-unity demonstrators waved Spanish, Catalan and European Union flags on the streets of Barcelona. Then this morning, Puigdemont posted a photo on Instagram of a courtyard at the seat of the regional presidency building, along with the words, "Good morning," in Catalan and a smiley face emoticon. Today, Spain's central government is expected to accuse him of rebellion for pushing ahead with secession. For more, we go to London, where we're joined by John Carlin, a journalist who has contributed to the Spanish newspaper El País since 1998. That is, until 2 weeks ago, when he was fired for writing an article in the Times of London headlined, "Catalan Independence: Arrogance of Madrid Explains This Chaos." John Carlin, welcome to Democracy Now! First, can you respond to what took place on Friday, and then how it was you ended up being fired by the newspaper you worked for more than for about 20 years?
Well, let me answer the second part first, because that happened 2 weeks ago. I don't really want to go into many details, but essentially it's because of articles I wrote on this Catalan question, political question that we're discussing now. In terms of what happened on Friday, well, it was a momentous day, an action-packed day in the history of Spain. Well, of any country, really, would have been, because in the morning you have the elected president of Catalonia. declaring independence unilaterally. And a matter of hours later, the Spanish Senate, with the backing of the Spanish government, as you mentioned before, passing into law this, or enabling rather, Article 155 of the Constitution, which allows the Spanish government to dissolve the Catalan Parliament, to fire the man who only hours earlier had declared independence, and to take over direct rule of all the institutions of government in Catalonia. That's where we're at now, and it's a very ugly and depressing and potentially dangerous situation.
John Carlin, also, to go back to your article and the articles you've written in general on this situation, what you've suggested is that it was Madrid's disproportionate response that's led to what's happening in Catalonia today. Can you explain why you think that's the case?
Well, it wasn't just a disproportionate response, which viewers may recall from the 1st of October when the police went in with clubs to stop people from voting in this sort of symbolic referendum that took place. It's actually been the response of the Spanish government in Madrid over the last 7 years consistently to the clamour for independence from around roughly half the Catalan population, although it's been growing every year. The fundamental problem is that what the Catalans wanted wasn't, they weren't clamoring for independence to be given just like that. They wanted a referendum on independence in the same way there was a referendum in Scotland on independence 3 years ago. They wanted the right to decide. And the Spanish government not only rejected that, they rejected all attempts at dialogue on the matter of giving Catalonia greater autonomous powers, maybe more control over the taxes, the judiciary. And generally, the attitude of Madrid towards the Catalan independence supporters has been one that has been dismissive, not to say rude, and lacking in respect. And this attitude, together with the refusal to countenance dialogue, the refusal to countenance a referendum, has increased the pro-independence vote in the last 7 years or so from probably around 10-15% to something close to 50%.
I want to turn back to the Spanish Deputy Prime Minister, Soraya Sáenz de Santamaría, who is speaking on Friday.
The president of the Generalitat will no longer be the president when this article is agreed on. He will no longer have the title of president of the Generalitat. He will not be able to make valid or obligatory decisions for others, nor for his own government, as a consequence of this secession. He will not be able to carry out his functions. He will stop being paid as the president of the Generalitat.
John Carlin, can you respond to what she said?
Well, look, I mean, unfortunately, she has something of a point. I don't like conceding that to the Spanish government, because I think they've acted so badly, mismanaged things so badly to get us to the present ugly situation we're in. But when Carles Puigdemont, the apparently now deposed president of Catalonia, declared independence unilaterally on Friday morning, he knew what he was getting himself in for. It was a red rag to a bull. He knew that this Article 155, which would depose him, was going to be enabled very soon thereafter. So, you know, he made his choice, and he must take the consequences. Now, there's one very important point, which actually there's some breaking news here, which I don't know if you're aware of, but in the last hour or so, the chief prosecutor in Madrid has charged Puigdemont, the president of Catalonia, now apparently deposed, with sedition and rebellion. Huge charges, which in theory, if he were to be proved guilty, could lead to a jail sentence of 30 years. The question now is whether the Spanish government, or rather the Spanish judiciary system, will go ahead and call for his arrest and indeed jail him. Should they do that, things could escalate rather dramatically and possibly violently in Catalonia.
I mean, this is major news. I'm also wondering how the Spanish news is covering this call to independence, the vote for independence, all that you're describing. I mean, John Carlin, you yourself were fired from the Spanish newspaper, the leading Spanish paper, El País, after you wrote an article on Catalonian independence. Can you talk about the kind of coverage it's getting and what people understand in Spain?
Well, look, in Spain, outside Catalonia, which is about 85% of national territory, there is a very, very strong sentiment against Catalan independence. There's actually a pretty strong prejudice against Catalans generally, which I think is part of the engine of all this rather non-compromising hard-line action being taken from Madrid. As far as the media are concerned, outside Catalonia is pretty unanimous. Certainly on public state Spanish television, it's extraordinarily biased in favour of the government, so much so that when there were these images went around the world of police clubbing people during the so-called referendum of 1st of October, very few of those images were shown on Spanish TV. But generally, the newspapers, too, in the rest of Spain, are very much in favour of this imposition of direct rule in Catalonia, the dissolution of the government, the charging of the president, as we've just recently heard. And in Catalonia, you actually get a rather more balanced position. Now, I should say, the Catalan state television is also immensely biased in favour of independence. But in the newspapers and in the radio in Catalonia, you're more likely to hear both sides of the argument.
Well, John Carlin, could you give us some context on why this is happening? I mean, Spain is a relatively decentralized country with 17 autonomous regions and two autonomous cities. So these autonomous regions do have a certain degree of autonomy, but Spain is not a federation. So could you talk about what kind of autonomy these regions enjoy and why Catalonia is different from the others? I mean, you spoke now of there being prejudice against Catalonia. So could you explain?
Yeah. Look, just before I address that sort of technical question, let me just say that there's a way maybe of explaining a bit to your viewers in the US. There is a clear similarity between that polarity of opinions and perceptions that you get in the US between those who support Trump and those who are against him. The similarity between that and in Spain, between those in favour of Catalan independence and against. And also, I think, probably rather as in the United States and here in London regarding the issue of Brexit, an awful lot of families have been divided, a lot of friends have fallen out over these political issues, only perhaps even more intensely and bitterly in Catalonia. In terms of your question, yes, the thing about the powers granted to the various autonomous regions, which would be the equivalent of states in the US, differ quite significantly from state to state. And that's a problem. That was something that was agreed in the 1978 constitution and barely changed since then. What you have is that Catalonia's actually got quite a lot more autonomous power than most of these regions, regional governments, but less than they have in the Basque Country. In the Basque Country, you've got almost, which is in the north of Spain, you have an almost sort of de facto independent state, with the critical thing that the government there is allowed to collect taxes and spend the money on taxes more or less as it wills. In the case of Catalonia, there is much less control over how the region uses its money. That's part of it. But it's also, we're talking here about sort of symbolic questions, more kind of human questions. And just if you'll bear with me a second, there was a government statute passed, approved by both the Catalan Parliament and the Spanish Parliament in 2006, which would have granted Catalonia significantly more autonomy and would have entrenched in the constitution their right to call themselves a nation. Now, in 2010, after pressure from the political party now in power, the Popular Party, the centre-right Popular Party, this statute, agreed by all parliaments, including the National Parliament in Spain, was overthrown by the Constitutional Court. That was, if you're going to find one moment where the Catalan independence wave began really to grow and grow and grow, it would be then, at what was perceived as this completely undemocratic action taken against Catalan's desire to increase its autonomous powers. And from then it's grown and grown and grown, and we are where we're at today.
John Carlin, we just have 30 seconds. But again, the breaking news that you just announced, the Spanish prosecutors seeking charges of rebellion and sedition and embezzlement against the ousted Catalan cabinet officials, including Puigdemont. Where do you see this going?
Well, we'll have to see. First of all, Puigdemont is supposed to present himself voluntarily in a court in Madrid. Will he do so? We don't know. If he doesn't, he will be a fugitive from the law. Will he present himself, and will he be, well, that he'd be formally charged? Will he then be arrested, and will he indeed be jailed? If that happens, all bets are off in Catalonia, and things could turn ugly and potentially violent.
I want to thank you so much for being with us. John Carlin, journalist, contributing writer at the Spanish newspaper El País since 1998. Well, until 2 weeks ago, when he was fired for writing an article in the Times of London headlined, "Catalan Independence Arrogance of Madrid Explains This Chaos." This is Democracy Now! When we come back, we go to Puerto Rico, where Democracy Now! Has just returned from, to get response to the governor saying that they will be canceling a $300 million contract with Whitefish Energy. Whitefish, named for the Montana town where the Interior Secretary, Ryan Zinke, comes from. This is Democracy Now! We'll also talk about North Korea and the escalating tensions between the U.S. and North Korea. Stay with us. The Song of the Birds by the Catalonian cellist Pablo Casals. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh.
We turn now to Puerto Rico, where Governor Ricardo Rossello announced on Sunday that he was instructing Puerto Rico's Electrical Power Authority, known as PREPA, to cancel its controversial $300 million contract with the tiny Montana-based company Whitefish Energy. The governor's move came after enormous pressure and scrutiny of the contract to reconstruct Puerto Rico's electrical power grid, devastated by Hurricane Maria. Whitefish Energy is based in the tiny hometown of Interior Secretary Ryan Zinke. The head of the private equity company that backs Whitefish, Joe Colonetta, was a Trump campaign donor. Meanwhile, Whitefish CEO Andrew Tekmansky argues his company's ability to mobilize quickly was vital to winning the contract.
All of this comes as a leaked copy of the no-bid contract sparked even further outrage last week when it was revealed that the terms barred penalties for work delays and prohibited the project from being audited by any U.S. government agency. Well, Democracy Now! Went down to Puerto Rico over the weekend, and I got a chance to sit down yesterday, on Sunday, with the head of UTIER, the Puerto Rico Electrical Workers Union, Angel Figueroa Jaramillo. We sat down in his office just as Governor Rossello was speaking. I began by asking him what he thought of the governor's announcement that he will be canceling the contract, that he's calling for the cancellation of the contract with Whitefish Energy.
What the government has just informed the country is that he's asking the governing board of the Puerto Rico Electric Power Authority to invoke the cancellation clause in the contract. We understand that this decision by the governor is in the face of the major questions that have been raised and the doubts that are circulating as to whether FEMA is going to be able to reimburse the money. And given the possibility that FEMA has distanced itself from reimbursing the money, and given the invoicing of $11 million, the governor is calling for the contract to be canceled. Nonetheless, in this process, he has not called for the resignation of engineer Ricardo Ramos, which is fundamental. He's the one who has defended this contract. He does not talk about continuing to investigate this whole process, and above all else, does not talk about cooperating in any federal investigation that might be undertaken into the Whitefish contract.
In the contract, which is just something like 50-odd pages for this $300 million deal, it says that
they can't be held to any timetable, and they cannot be audited by any U.S. agency. Now, this is a company whose largest deal, I think, was something like $1.3 million to build 4.8 miles of transmission lines in Arizona. That was its largest deal. You're talking about 2,400 miles of transmission lines here in Puerto Rico.
Precisely, that was the first question that was raised. This was a company without experience, and its only experience is in places totally different from Puerto Rico. And to grant a contract for $300 million was to deposit a lot of money, deposit a lot of work in a totally inexperienced company. But most particular in this process are the conditions of the contract. How is it possible that you can have a contract that can't be audited, that can't be called into question, where the contract says that it is complying with federal regulations when it isn't, and still, to this date, Whitefish continues to be contracted. No one has moved away from that contract. We need to call into question the people who brought about this contract and to call into question the participation of FEMA if FEMA had any involvement. Today, FEMA says, I had nothing to do with the contract. Everyone is moving away from this contract. I think that this contract must have been seen and reviewed by many people other than Ricardo Ramos.
Do you believe FEMA had a role in this? They say they didn't look at the contract. It's PREPA's fault.
It's interesting, FEMA's response when it found out about the scandal. As long as Whitefish was being called into question, while the government of Puerto Rico was telling the country that FEMA was going to reimburse the money, FEMA didn't react. It's only now that the Congress of the United States, that the media in the United States and worldwide has called into question this contract. FEMA only reacted on Friday, saying it had nothing to do with the contract. So we need to call into question the silence, why there was so much silence for such a long time.
Ryan Zinke's son, the Interior Secretary, worked for Whitefish, not to mention Whitefish is Ryan Zinke's hometown. Do you think Ryan Zinke should be investigated? How did this contract happen? And have you met with Andrew Tekmansky, who's running the show here, all of the Whitefish workers that they are importing? Not that there are that many right now.
Here, everything needs to be investigated. Whitefish didn't just come to Puerto Rico by accident, a very small company from Montana that no one knew about, coming into Puerto Rico with a $300 million contract. There must have been some connection to be able to come to Puerto Rico. It just it wasn't in the Internet. There wasn't a classified ad. Somebody must have called Puerto Rico for them. Whitefish has ties with companies in Brazil. Ricardo Ramos worked in Odebrecht, the Brazilian company. That's another angle that needs to be investigated, the Brazilian company in this process.
What is the name of the Brazilian company?
We still don't know the name of the Brazilian company. This is a report by the Environment News in the United States. It noted that this company was financing Whitefish for 2 years. When we saw that news, we drew the relationship with Odebrecht, which was a Brazilian company that has been pointed out by the U.S. Department of Justice as the most corrupt company in Latin America. And the Dominican Republic is the country where there was most corruption. Nonetheless, by chance, Ricardo Ramos worked with Odebrecht in the Dominican Republic.
Do you think Ricardo Ramos, the head of PREPA, who signed this $300 million contract, should be fired?
Clearly, and not only that, I believe that a much deeper investigation needs to be carried out in Puerto Rico. There is an element that has always come about in these kinds of situations, which is impunity. Nothing happens, the money is stolen, and then nothing happens. I believe that this is the time to make sure that these contracts don't happen again, to take this to the ultimate consequences, and if people need to be put in prison, the local and federal officials who may have been involved in this Whitefish process need to be put in prison as well.
What is it like for Puerto Rican workers to be working alongside of workers from the continental United States who are apparently, reportedly, being paid much more to do the same job.
Not only the same job, the ones who really know the Puerto Rican electoral system are us. They've worked much more slowly, with much more difficulty on the work assigned to them compared to us. Seeing that big difference, looking at Puerto Rico, its topography, its geography, the complexity of our electrical system, one sees that this is a big scandal when some workers are being paid $200 an hour doing the same work that we do for $21 an hour. There's a difference there. One notes how poorly paid we are, but also it shows just how much corruption there is around whitefish.
If the public power union, if the workers, if PREPA got this money to rebuild Puerto Rico's power grid, what could you do with it? $300 million.
With much less than that amount, indeed with the help of workers from companies in the United States who have experience with international assistance, Mexico, the Mexican Electrical Workers Union, has made themselves available, workers who would be experts on the lines. With a lot of help, we'd be able to rebuild the country with much less money than has been given to whitefish.
I want to ask you about Elon Musk and solar power. There's a lot being made in the United States, continental United States, and the corporate media about his offer saying that Puerto Rico could be the experiment, the model for the rest of the country for solar power. This goes to two issues. One is the entire grid is down. How do you rebuild it in a more sustainable way? And does solar have to mean privatization?
First, the complexity of the electrical system of Puerto Rico. It's a totally isolated system. A system with a large amount of demand poses a major challenge in terms of looking at the possibility of solar power for power in the whole country. It's very complex. It requires many studies, a lot of analysis, many evaluations, and the people of Puerto Rico can't wait for all of that right now. Now, that doesn't mean that Puerto Rico doesn't have to look very seriously at the possibility of a transformation towards solar power. Nonetheless, the transformation that UTIER believes is most appropriate are solar communities. The communities themselves should appropriate that system. It's not that we will become a commodity for renewable solar energy companies.
And now you have a member of the Fiscal Control Board, former Air Force Colonel Noel Zamot, reportedly about to be imposed as an emergency manager over PREPA. Can you talk about the significance of this and who he is?
Amy.
First, the UTIER, I want to be clear on this, doesn't support the Fiscal Control Board and obviously doesn't support this appointment. I don't want to make that clear to all the media. Nonetheless, the law allows the Fiscal Control Board to make an appointment such as this in extraordinary circumstances. That means this appointment is being made because there are irregularities in control of whitefish, the contract, and they are concerned that they're not going to be able to satisfy the creditors. I agree. I don't agree with the appointment. The Zamot will, his appointment, if it will be a major challenge. He doesn't know anything about the electrical industry, has no expertise in this area, and so we are struck by Samo's appointment to be an overseer of the PREPA.
So you had, what, over 6,000 workers in 2000, and now you're down to 3,500? It's almost halved. Do you believe that, and this goes before the Fiscal Control Board, that there are efforts being made simply to destroy the largest public power authority in the United States so that it is sold off, privatized?
Sí, totalmente. La UTIER ha venido señalando desde el...
Yes, clearly. The UTIER has been denouncing this plan, talking about, for years, talking about how they were going to run down the service, make the service more expensive, how at the same time they were going to carry out a campaign vis-a-vis the Puerto Rican people, and reducing resources earmarked to the service, all with a view to privatizing the company. The UTIER has been consistent for 18 years. Is warning the country about the route that the government has been following in Puerto Rico.
The author Naomi Klein wrote a book called The Shock Doctrine, The Rise of Disaster Capitalism. And in it, she points out in times of disaster, precisely like Hurricane Maria in Puerto Rico, those in power use the moment to consolidate their power and to take from the population. How can you turn that around to use this absolutely cataclysmic moment right now in Puerto Rico to reverse that trend, to establish a sustainable economy in Puerto Rico?
Precisamente eso es lo que están haciendo en Puerto Rico.
That is precisely what they're doing in Puerto Rico, applying the shock doctrine. Yes, something different could be done. And I believe that media such as yourselves could help us do something different. Puerto Rico often hears more from what's happening outside than what about what's happening in Puerto Rico than rather than hearing within Puerto Rico. It's difficult. We need to be consistent with our message. Little by little, it is penetrating, and little by little, the country is realizing that, as in this case of Whitefish, it's one of those capitalism disasters.
In contrast to a colonial recovery, what would a Puerto Rican reconstruction look like that's done for the benefit of Puerto Ricans for this island?
The first, and I'm going to speak as Andres Figueroa, Puerto Rican, not as the president of the UTIER, who believes that Puerto Rico should have all the powers of any country in the world to be able to develop economically. The first thing is that the U.S. Congress should recognize our right to self-determination as regards our future with no intervention of the Congress, just recognizing that we Puerto Ricans want for the future is something that they will totally accept within a system of total decolonization. This first. And it begins by taking down the fiscal control board. That's the first thing that the Congress should show within what they have said publicly about democracy. The U.S. Constitution says clearly that with the end of slavery, no power can be held over and against the rights of a people. Puerto Rico is a people, and we cannot allow the Congress to continue to treat Puerto Rico colonially, as it is, like a colony, as it's doing.
As we wrap up this interview, I can't help but notice over your left shoulder, among the pictures on the wall and posters, is a poster of Che Guevara. What is his significance in your life? What does he mean to you?
Che Guevara, junto a muchos,
Che Guevara, like other leaders in Latin America, shows the solidarity that we Latin American peoples must have at all times. He's an Argentine who went to Cuba, an Argentine who went to Bolivia, an Argentine who went to Latin America. That means that we, the Latin American peoples, need to break down the borders that divide us as countries, as peoples, so as to have a single voice, so as to have greater prosperity, more democracy, greater, more happiness. That's our aspiration as a people, and that is what Che Guevara represented at a given point in time for all of Latin America. And that example of solidarity, of breaking down the barriers that divide us as a nation, is what we aspire to as Puerto Ricans.
That's Ángel Figueroa Jaramillo. He is head of UTIER, the Puerto Rico Electrical Workers Union. PREPA, the Puerto Rican Power Authority, is the largest public power authority in the United States. I spoke with him on Sunday in his office in San Juan, just as Puerto Rico's governor, Ricardo Rosselló, was calling for the partial cancellation of the power company's contract with the Montana-based company Whitefish Energy, hometown of Interior Secretary Ryan Zinke. The company is 2 years old and had just two employees the day Hurricane Maria hit Puerto Rico. Special thanks to Sam Alkoff, Laura Gadasdiener, Juan Carlos Davila, Dennis Moynihan and Charlie Roberts. This is Democracy Now! Back in a minute.
Soy lo que dejaron, soy toda la sobra de lo que se robaron. Un pueblo escondido en la cima, mi piel es de cuero, por eso aguanta cualquier clima. Soy una fábrica de humo, mano de obra campesina para tu consumo. Frente de frío en el medio del verano, el amor en los tiempos del cólera, mi hermano. El sol que nace y el día que muere, con los mejores atardeceres. Soy el desarrollo en carne viva, un discurso político.
Latino America, by Calle 3. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh.
We turn now to North Korea, where tensions continue to mount with the United States. During a week-long visit to Asia, Defense Secretary James Mattis emphasized a diplomatic resolution to the standoff between the two countries, but warned that the U.S. would not accept a nuclear North Korea. This is Mattis speaking Saturday during a meeting with his South Korean counterpart, Song Yang-moo, in Seoul.
Make no mistake, any attack on the United States or our allies will be defeated. Any use of nuclear weapons by the North will be met with a massive military response, effective and overwhelming. I cannot imagine a condition under which the United States would accept North Korea as a nuclear power.
Mattis arrived in South Korea on Friday for a two-day trip to the country ahead of a visit later this week to the region by President Trump. Trump is slated to visit China, Vietnam, Japan, the Philippines and South Korea over a 12-day visit. White House officials are divided over whether Trump should visit the demilitarized zone between the North and South during the trip, with concerns that a visit could further exacerbate the threat of nuclear war.
Tensions between North Korea and the United States have been building after a series of nuclear and missile texts by Pyongyang and intense verbal exchanges between Trump and North Korean leader Kim Jong-un. Trump has threatened to destroy all of North Korea, a nation of 25 million people. Trump tweeted last month, "Just heard Foreign Minister of North Korea speak at UN. If he echoes thoughts of Little Rocket Man, they won't be around too much longer." Trump's tweet came as North Korean Foreign Minister Ri Yong-ho said Trump was on a suicide mission. Congressional Democrats are pushing legislation that would prevent President Trump from launching a preemptive strike against North Korea. Well, for more, we're joined by Christine Ahn, founder and executive director of Women Cross DMZ, a global movement of women mobilizing to end the Korean War. She's speaking to us from Hawaii. Christine, thanks for joining us once again on Democracy Now! Can you talk about the conclusion of this visit by Mattis and the escalation once again of the U.S.-North Korea tensions and what we can expect as President Trump goes to the region in a few days?
Good morning, Amy. It seems that Mattis's statement, especially at the DMZ, that the U.S. does not want to go to war with North Korea, was kind of a preemptive statement before ahead of Trump's visit to Asia, particularly to South Korea, where more South Koreans fear Donald Trump than they do Kim Jong-un. And in fact, massive protests are being planned. There was the anniversary of the Candlelight Revolution this past weekend, and over 220 civil society organizations declared that they would hold massive protests from November 4th through the 7th all throughout the country, declaring no war, no more military exercises, stop the brinkmanship, which obviously threatens the majority of people in South Korea, and also many who still have family in North Korea. So I think that, you know, it was a kind of a proactive step to, assuage the South Korean people, because obviously Trump will come in and make some provocative statements. And I think that was part of the step to do that. What we don't often hear in the media, though, is that the U.S. has sent 3 nuclear aircraft carriers to be docked on the Korean Peninsula. They have been conducting very provocative joint war exercises with South Korea, included Navy SEALs that took out Osama bin Laden. They do include the decapitation strikes. And so, you know, it's one thing to say we don't want war with North Korea, and another to actually be laying the grounds for that. And it's not just the provocative military actions that are, you know, underway, but the threats. I mean, we continue to hear threats from throughout the Trump cabinet. Mike Pompeo, the CIA director, stated at a Defense Forum Foundation this past week that assassination plots were underway for Kim Jong-un. H.R. McMaster has said, you know, acceptance and deterrence is not an option. And Tillerson has said that, you know, we're going to talk until the first bomb drops. So, you know, this is not really inviting North Korea to engage in dialogue, which is urgently what is needed.
Well, could you say a little, Christine, about how North Korea responded? You just mentioned that South Korea and the U.S. held military exercises recently. What was North Korea's response to those exercises? And is there reason to believe that North Korea is still open to negotiations? Because that's not the sense that we get here in the media.
Absolutely. Well, I think it's important to note that we haven't seen any missile tests or nuclear tests in almost 38 days from the North Korean side. I don't think that that means that they're not going to continue. They have made it very clear that they are on a path to achieving a nuclear, you know, an ICBM that could attach a nuclear warhead that could strike the United States. And, you know, many estimates is that they're months away from doing that. But, you know, I don't know if you recall, after Trump's, you know, totally destroy North Korea speech with the UN, the North Korean foreign minister, Ri Yong-ho, said that, you know, and I guess what had happened was, over that weekend, the U.S. flew, you know, F-15 fighter jets across the northern limit line on the maritime border. That's in complete violation of, you know, an agreement that that northern limit line would be the line that would not be crossed to prevent any kind of skirmishes. And so, in response to that, North Korea has said, we will strike and take down U.S. planes, even if they are not in within our orbit or within our, you know, geographic area. And so, you know, North Korea has made clear that they are going to counter-retaliate. And so, given that there are no channels, really, official channels, there are some small private channels that are being held, you know, 1.5 talks between former U.S. officials with the North Korean government, there really aren't talks underway. And I think that's what's the dangerous situation that we're in, is, you know, when the next North Korean test is conducted, will the U.S. be ready to strike it? And would that then be the beginning of a very dangerous escalation? In fact, you know, the Congressional Research Service just issued a report on Friday. They said that within the first few days, 330,000 people would be killed instantly. And that's just using conventional weapons. And once you include nuclear weapons, you know, they estimate 25 million people. I mean, how do you estimate the number of people, especially in a region where Japan, South Korea, China, Russia, and you have North Korea, obviously, that possesses up to 60 nuclear weapons.
So, Christine, we just have 20 seconds, but what about this debate of whether President Trump should visit the demilitarized zone, the significance of this?
Well, I think that he is not planning to visit there, I think, because, you know, his administration is worried that he's going to make some provocative statements that could really trigger the North Koreans. And so, right now, I think what is really important is that there is grassroots mobilization across the country, in the United States, massive protests being planned for November 11th for Armistice Day by Veterans for Peace.
We're going to have to leave it there, Christine, but we'll do part 2 and post online at democracynow.org. I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh. Thanks for joining us.